All right, I'm going to present work by Alex Zhu, who is here and will make the demos also during the breaks. Nikolai Atanasov, who is now studying as faculty at the UC San Diego. And this is work, it is 2017, not 2007, that's a typo. I just entered it there. Well, we present it here, and we're going to present also at the CVPR 2017. We are pretty new in event-based cameras. I mean, we are almost 5 years late. I think there are very good papers already, 2011, 2012. But we are really fascinated by not only the architecture of the systems, but really what they can do in very fast scenes and also under very challenging illumination conditions. And this is really an example here where on the left you see the grayscale image from the DAVIS camera and on the right you see our picture tracker. And obviously not only because of the darkness but also because of the motion blur, you see all the trails that the lights are leaving in the scene. It is almost impossible to do any estimation of features, not only just for tracking in 2D, but definitely not for visual odometry in SLAM. Another example, we went to I-76 in Philadelphia, and we just put the DAVIS camera next to the highway, capturing cars at 60 miles per hour. The optical flow is 5,000 pixels per second, and obviously the first question I was asking myself, okay, I mean, Toby's camera is amazing, but the iPhone has also 240 frames per second. And my students, Oleg and Arotiski's company, was running visual odometry on 240 frames per second, was sold to Apple for quite a big acquisition price, right? But then you will see actually that even with 240 frames per second with the iPhone 6, and with running KLT, you don't get the feature tracks that you get with the DAVIS camera. And you really see that everything is really slowed down here. I mean, this is the beauty of event-based cameras. Everybody else in robotics in the rest of the conference is accelerating the video because the videos are embarrassingly slow. And in event-based cameras, you really have to slow them down in order to show what you're doing. So that's really amazing. And so speed and darkness and highlights and sun, this is what we really want to solve. And this is just an animation of what a frame-based camera does. And this is the animation what you get in XT without Y of an event-based camera. And Toby already described where you get the events in time and the sign of the gradient when you have a threshold in the difference of the logarithms. And what we really want is to follow a feature based, not a direct approach for visual odometry or SLAM. And also because we believe that 2D features, good traction 2D features are very useful just even in 2D. So what is a feature in event-based systems? In classic vision, a feature is usually something that is defined by a spatial neighborhood. This is, you will find it in many lectures, and this is slides from David Law. And the good news about us in event-based systems is that a good feature is defined through motion. Even the classic Lucas Canade paper 1981 started really with a motion definition. And a good feature is really a feature where you can find good optical flow. So this is already a good indication, good news for the event-based cameras. The bad news for the event-based cameras is that you always define a neighborhood. This is a square, and you really look inside the square whether you get an aperture problem or completely unobservable motion or a very good corner. And in addition, you have the problem of time. So, and if it is very fast and it is outside this neighborhood, you cannot even capture the optical flow. So you really have to deal over multiple scales, or you will have to build a pyramid with wavelets or scatter filters, and really have then an inference, and the best inference, the first actually really throughout inference, including probability, and I'm really very inspired by this, is by Eros and Ocelli in the Bayesian multiscale differential optical flow, where you have a very fast pattern like the one moving on the left. If you have just a blind gradient estimation of multiple scales without probabilities, it is on the upper right, with covariance propagation at the bottom left, and this is the certainty you get. Obviously, the dark areas, you don't have a, you have a very bad estimates. So this is these are really the two main limitations from what we know. So we cannot use a fixed spatial window. We already know that for fast scenes, because it really depends on the optical flow. But also, we really don't know what is a feature in the in the spatial domain, because there is no frame. We define, we started really from very basic principles, and for many of us who started with a PhD in the 20th century, a point was a point. So it was, and you would project it in the image with a classic projection equation with intrinsics and rotation translation. And you would get a geometric point. A geometric point never existed in the image, because the image was just a distribution with intensities, and it doesn't exist also here. There is not one event per point. But if it was and one event per geometric point, then you would get something that is like this very nice, actually, curves, or if the optical flow is constant, very nice lines in x, y, and t. But usually, for many reasons that Toby also explained, you get multiple events, you get a lot of noise, and you have also texture around your XYT event-based volume looks like this. So you really don't know there is no gradient, there is no surface, the way we get it in the classical frames. So you really don't know who is what. So, and we model this by the following way. We say that we get an event from a feature, not only by adding noise, which is really because there is a variation even from the just from the pixel quantization, not only from the electrical noise, but also we have an association problem, a data association pi, which will tell us for every feature to which, for every event, to which feature it would belong. So we don't try just to reconstruct actually the noise, but we really try to find the membership of every event to a particular feature in the scene. So and, this is a very nice animation. Let's say you have a camera looking at this star. These are the events you are getting after the perspective projection in the X, Y, and T. And if you look exactly at one point, like the red point over there in the sky, in the star, in the neighborhood, you get exactly this pattern. And obviously, this is really a very nice situation with the blue lines and animated. But we need some constraint in order to define this association. And the constraint we use is really the same constraint as in Lucas Carnati, pretty much, that there is some neighborhood, but not fixed. Neither in pixels nor in time, which where the optical flow is constant, which means these are you see these very nice lines over there. If you write this down, you have that if x is an xy vector and you have as is associated with a timestamp pi and xk with timestamp pk, then if they have a constant velocity, this should be compensate if they're associated with the same feature. So if the association of I and associated k is equal to j. But we don't know this. So this is like a hidden, it's like a latent variable in our system. So whenever you have a latent variable in the system, so which event to which feature it belongs, then the usual thing to solve this data association problem is expectation maximization. So you really try first to compensate to minimize the expectation of this with respect to all possible assignments for every point, and then to maximize with respect to the optical flow, which is your parameter, your model here. And this is what you get. So what we do is we have this, this is pretty much the corresponding minimization problem to, for example, a total variation, but here without any gradient, without reconstructing, is everything really just probabilistic with a V as unknown locally, and every actually event has a chance to grab on a feature. And this assignment is this Rij and Rkj. And this is solved in two steps, as usually. And one is the expectation step, and one is the maximization step. And this is the warping you see there is really if you shift every feature by the by every event by the associated V, and this is just when you look at it from above, the XY image, where you try to everything really is overlapping after warping it back. So the E step is very easy to solve. You assume a Gaussian distribution with a mean around the center, the actual the projection of the geometric feature and a covariance. And this is really a closed form for the belongingness of every event to a particular feature. And after you find this, you plug it in, and then you have just a big linear system V, which of course suffers from all problems that the optical flow computation has, which means that it might, you, it, might have an aperture problem. You don't, or if there is flickering or anything like this, you might have just an impossible solution. So, but still we haven't answered the question how long should we look a long time, okay? So we cannot really make the summation over the whole image. So somehow we have to constrain it. And the way we constrain it is, this is something we realized from the first week we started working with event-based systems, is that you cannot have a fixed time window. Also, if, even if this time window is like 2 milliseconds or 5 milliseconds. And you see actually here several windows when you overlap them in the Davis camera, but this is a much more beautiful animaire, actually representation of the length of the features which have the same optical flow. And this is our definition of a temporal neighborhood. Our definition of a temporal neighborhood is we try to group together the pixels which have, for example, one pixel optical flow, or 2 or 3. And this 1, 2, or 3 is determined by this K. And you could do it, if you had a lot of processing power, you could do it separately at every neighborhood. But here we actually choose the median or the third quartile of the distribution of the flow. And this is what we set as the temporal window. But where do you know the flow from? So this is actually the second chicken and egg problem here. The first chicken and egg is like every the bit, how which events to group in order to compute the optical flow, which we solve with a soft assignment. But also because you cannot look in the into varying time, and also you want pretty much a causal system, you have to constrain the time, and this is solved in an alternating way. So we compute, we solve the EM maximization for the which events belongs to which feature and the flow, and then determine the time, and then we go back and recompute the flow computation. Now, if you want a good tracking in two dimensions, then you really want it to last long. And Carlo Tomasi, in the paper with my friend Jumbo Shi, when they wrote the good features to track paper, the idea was that we have to define a feature not only in terms of how good a corner it is, but also we have to monitor its quality over time with respect to persistence and occlusions, etc. And this is what we, and this is important here because really of the mess you see actually in this spatiotemporal volume of the features. And this is the second step we do, where we take a template and we try to stabilize with respect to this template. So template is the red here, and we try to stabilize over the lifetime of a feature so that everything actually really overlaps at this first event. And this is, we do exactly the same as in the first step, but expanding the way Carlo Tomasi and Giambosi described, that you have a drift B and an affine deformation over many frames, the A. And again, the belongingness to the affine model, to this model, is really solved with an expectation step, and then A and B is again a linear overconstrained system. So then we worked these events, and here actually you can see in this picture that every actually the, where they really end up inside these circles is the scope of each feature, which is we put a threshold in the Rij, the belongingness, the probability belongs to this feature, and this is how big actually is the computed neighborhood at the end. So we run this into we always make comparisons with this is actually, I think as the scientific method tells us that we really, I mean, we always have to compare if we can in terms of speed or lighting with a traditional camera, and this is a comparison with the gray value image, and this is the error. This is like half and one pixel. It is it's about one average of one pixel difference to the KLT. We believe that because it is a very slow sequence and the gray values are nice, the KLT here is pretty much groundless. Now, if we want to go farther and compute the visual odometry, we would need some more sparse features, and I follow there more the school from sliding window band adjustment and the MSEK filter, where we try to solve everything with as few features as possible. So what we do actually after the last step is, and after we warp everything on the same, we try actually to detect like fast corners in this image so that we avoid completely areas where we have an aperture problem, like on the upper right of this scene. This is really like an engineering step in order to get a few features for our visual inertial odometry. Our odometry itself is nothing else than the multi-state constraint Kalman filter by Sergius Rumeliotis. We use the IMU observations as we use exactly the same elimination of structure during the temporal window of poses, and the main difference that we do in the 2D tracking, because we have a very good pose, we don't have to assume an arbitrary affine warping here, but we can really get the estimate of the pose, and particularly the 3D rotation, and we use it directly for the definition of our features, which means we really derotate them locally. And as a matter of fact, at the beginning we had done this just with the IMU measurement, but with the MCKF we really get excellent estimates of rotation. And so that for the second step of the flow we compute only a scale and the local translation. And in order to make it like a good engineering system, there is no way, unless you use it direct or semi-direct method, we follow the old school where we really have to use RANSAC. We've done a lot of work on solving efficiently one and two and 3 point RANSACs. Here, as a matter of fact, we have one RANSAC among the points for pure translation, and a second one which is for the best triangulation, which is RANSAC among multiple frames inside the window of the MSEKF. And this is the whole system of the EBIO, It has, for the feature tracking, it has the two EM steps, and it has two more RATSAC steps in order to provide very good features. And indeed, they are really the features. So you can see this is a very general scene from the, I guess this is from the benchmark, right?
Yeah.
Thanks, we really thank, I mean, Davide got showed courage there and provided the first benchmark, and I really urge ourselves and the whole community to get as many benchmarks as possible. The way we estimated there is that we have the EVIO is the top of blue. We have a KLT running on the gray value part of the Davis. And we have also ground truth given by David. And this is this is pretty much like a PTAM scene, like the one that Andrew has shown. And really, we do here only odometry. We don't do any mapping. This is a much more challenging scene with high dynamic range. And all the features we detect after the two steps of the 2D tracking and the RANSAC. This is a scene having a motion independent of the camera, all of them from the Zurich benchmark. And we have two sequences with, these are from a platform we use together with David and Toby in the DARPA FLA. I mean, this is not the actual trial platform, but this is where it runs over a floor. This is really like a nice environment from the event-based camera, and indeed, actually, the EVIO gives us really beautiful results. You can see also a map there, but it's nothing interesting because it's only a plane visible. And this is a sequence which is over grass. And this is very interesting because there is there are events everywhere, and we're really very surprised that we get so clear parts of our features there. And the speed is also slowed down. Again, actually, this is really what I like, that we have to slow down the scenes instead of speeding them up. And this is the reconstruction we get of the path, the green path. And we are really pushing forward to have it in a more challenging maneuvers. So this is really a very exciting field, and I really thank Davide and Andreas who started this workshop. In 2000, we had started the first workshop of omnidirectional vision, and this ended up, I mean, omnidirectional cameras ended up on the Dyson that Andrew showed. You can find kind of dioptric systems for every iPhone for $15, which you put as an attachment, and with a mirror you get all directional images. This became textbook material, and I think actually this is the scope of this probably is one-tenth out of the scope what we can do with event-based systems, because event-based systems the geometry might be the same, although we can combine them still with omnidirectional. But there is really so many actually new things we can do with the processing and the way we perceive space and time in vision. Thank you very much.